Hi, hi everyone. A warm welcome to all of you, and a very good morning. My name is V. Dinesh Babu, and I am from Department of Computer Science and Engineering from Chevrolet Engineering College. And today I want to explain about the AWT and swings in Java programming language. So the full form of AWT is Abstract Window Toolkit, and we use this AWT to develop graphical user interface components. We all know the graphical user interface components. We have when we are using a computer system, we have icons which are called as graphical user interface components, and similarly, there are some of the examples of these graphical user interface components. And these are some of the examples of graphical user interface components which will be developed by using AWT or swings. So the examples of these graphical user interface components are labels, scroll bars, radio buttons, and check boxes, and we have text boxes and text areas, and there are different type of some other graphical user interface components. We develop all these graphical user interface components by using these two packages in Java, AWT and swings. Right. Let's discuss about AWT. After discussing about the AWT, we will go for the swings. Now AWT, so these are the components which are developed by using the AWT package are called as heavyweight components. They are called as heavyweight components. Why we call these as heavyweight components? In the sense, these components are not generated directly. And what do you mean by generating directly and generating indirectly? In the sense, let us consider an example. In AWT, when we want to create a button is also a graphical user interface components. We already seen multiple types of AWT components. We already saw in the first slide, these are the different types of AWT components: labels, text fields, scroll bars, radio buttons, check boxes. Similar to these components, we have buttons, and then list, choice boxes. These are the different types of AWT. So among all those AWT components, button is also one of the component. So in AWT, when we want to create a button, we simply create an object for button class. We have button class in AWT package. And by using that button class in AWT package, we are going to create. There is one class called as button class. So in AWT, when we want to create a button, we simply create an object for button class. And when we want to create a label, we simply create an object for label class. When we want to create a checkbox, we simply create an object for checkbox class. So there are some default classes in AWT package which are used for the creation of these graphical user interface components, right? So let us see how we can create buttons in AWT. So here there is one statement called as button space b equal to new button. So here button is one of the class name in AWT package. And we all know the creation of object in Java programming language: class name space object name equal to new class name. Right here, our class name is button, and we are going to take our object name as b. So button space b equal to. So whenever we want to create an object, we have to use the new keyword. So button space b equal to new button. So this particular statement will generate a button on the output screen. So this particular statement will create a button on the output screen. But what is happening inside the computer system or inside the JVM is that, So this statement, there is one point in under the statement. This statement will interact with the system files of button creation. So it will generate a button. So you can see this button space B equal to new button is not creating the button directly. It is going to interact with the system files of button creation. So in computer system, there are multiple number of files. So each and every file has their own purpose and own usage. So for creating button, there are some files. For creating radio buttons, there are some files. For creating checkboxes, there are some files. And so whenever we write a statement button space B equal to new button, this particular statement is going to interact with the button creation files inside our computer system. And then it will generate a button. So what happens is, we all know that Java virtual machine only understands bytecode. Will not understand even our any programming language or even our any English language or nothing. It only understands bytecode. So here my question is that system files, so our system has multiple number of files, are those files are in bytecode or are they in some other code? Definitely they will not be in the bytecode. So how this JVM is going to understand those system files which are not in the bytecode? So here the solution for this one is peer files. There are some files which are called as peer files, which will help the JVM to understand these system files. Okay, let us revive the theme what we have discussed from the last 2 or 3 minutes. While we are using AWT, we are calling these AWT components as heavyweight components. Why we are calling these as a heavyweight components? In the sense, they are not generated directly. So we are justifying this point, not generated directly. So when simply we are considering one example of button creation in Java programming language by using AWT package. Well, we want to create a button in AWT. We are writing the statement as button space B equal to new button. So this particular statement will generate a button on the output screen. This is what we see. And what is happening inside the system is that whenever we write a statement button space B equal to new button and we try to compile and run that particular program, that program is going to interact with the system files which are used for button creation. And after interacting with the system files, a button will be created on the output screen. Now here my question is, so Java virtual machine is going to deal with all the Java programs. Whenever the Java program is compiled, the entire Java program is converted into bytecode, and this bytecode is given to the JVM in order to execute and in order to show the output of that particular program. So JVM only understands the bytecode, but how these system files, which are not in the bytecode, or generating a button, or generating a checkbox, or generating a radio button, or generating a label, or anything else. How these system files, which are not in the bytecode, are generating particular graphical user interface components is my question. So the solution for this question is, there are some files called as peer files, and these peer files will help the JVM, will help the Java virtual machine to understand the system files. So simply creating a button, we are creating an object for button class, and that particular statement is going to interact with the system files, and JVM is not understanding the system files. That is why JVM is using some other files called as peer files, and these peer files will help the JVM to understand these system files. So for simple, a button creation statement is interacting with the system files, is using the peer files, and these peer files are, we cannot say that peer files are converting these system files into bytecode. So this much heavy process is involved inside each and every component creation by using AWT. That is why these AWT components are called as heavyweight components. Right. Next one. We all know one of the best feature of Java programming language is machine independency. Machine independence. The Java program will never depend upon the computer system. When we write a Java program and when we try to run this program in multiple number of computer systems which are of different configurations, that particular Java program will provide same output irrespective of the configuration of the computer systems in and around the world. We may use any type of computer system. We may use any type of laptop, or we may use any type of other communicating device which can run Java program. And that particular device, particular computer system, particular laptop will never show a different output. All the computer systems will show the same output, because in every system, when we compile this Java program, it will be converted into bytecode. And our computer system does not understand the bytecode. Computer system only understands the machine level language, which is in the form of ones and zeros. It will never understand the bytecode. It is some other intermediate code. Bytecode is not a machine code. It is some other intermediate code between high level language and machine level language. It is some other intermediate code. The name of that code is bytecode. And that bytecode is only understood by the JVM. Here, any computer system having JVM will understand that bytecode and will give the same output. So here, when we are using AWT components, we already seen one example. When we are trying to create a button space be equal to new button by using that statement, when we are trying to create a button, that button statement is going to interact with the system files. Whenever that button statement is interacting with the system files, that means that particular statement is depending upon the computer system. Now, how can we say that Java is a machine depend? There is a mistake in my PPT. I just corrected now. Now, how can we say that Java is a machine independent language now? As we saw that button creation file is depending upon the system file. When we write a code for creating checkboxes, but checkboxes statement will depend upon system files. When we write a code regarding the creation of radio buttons, that radio button statement will depend upon system files. So each and every statement we are writing by using AWT is depending upon computer system. Now, how can we say that Java is a machine independent programming language? Yes. Java is a machine independent programming language, but machine independency feature of Java is violated when we use AWT. So when we are trying to generate graphical user interface components by using AWT package, that AWT package contains multiple number of classes. All these classes are depending on the system files. So here the machine independency feature of Java programming language is violated, because AWT classes does not contain the code for button creation, the code for checkboxes, the code for scroll bars, the code for list boxes, etc. So the each and every class is going to depend upon the system files. So that is why when we use AWT in Java programming language, the most and important feature of Java programming language is going to be violated, and that is machine independence. And now, if I want to generate graphical user interface components and I want to preserve the machine independency feature of Java, right? So AWT are heavyweight components, and by using AWT, we are violating the most important feature of Java, that is machine independency. But now I want to generate graphical user interface components. So graphical user interface components are developed by using AWT. But when we are using AWT, it is violating our machine independency feature of Java programming language. So the solution in order to preserve this graphic, in order to preserve the machine independency feature of Java, at the same time, I want to generate graphical user interface components. The solution for both these points is Sphinx. Sphinx is one of the package similar to AWT. Sphinx is one of the package similar to AWT in Java programming language. By using Sphinx also, we can develop graphical user interface components. And the components which are developed by using Sphinx are called as lightweight components. So the components which are developed by using Sphinx are called as lightweight components. So why we call this as lightweight components in the sense, if we want to create a button by using Sphinx, we will write the statement as J button space B equal to new J button. So this particular statement will create a button on the output screen directly. It will never interact with the system files. It will never use the peer files. And it does not depend upon any computer system. It will directly create a button on the output screen, because Sphinx also, as we seen in the previous PPT, Sphinx also use it to create graphical user interface components. All the Sphinx, all the classes of the Sphinx package contains the creation code directly. If we want to create a button by using Sphinx, we use the class JButton. That JButton class contains the button creation code. But while we are using AWT components, when we want to create a button, we use button space B equal to new button. That button class does not contain the button creation code. That button class contains the procedure of interacting with the system files of button creation. But here, JButton class contains button creation code. When we want to create a checkbox, we use the class JCheckbox space some object name equal to new JCheckbox. That JCheckbox class directly contains the checkbox creation code. And similarly, when we want to create a scroll bar in AWT, we use scroll bar space B equal to new scroll bar. And within the braces, when we want to create, we have two types of scroll bars, we know, horizontal scroll bar and vertical scroll bar. When we want to create a horizontal scroll bar, we use scroll bar dot horizontal as a parameter. And when we want to use, when we want to create a vertical, we use the scroll bar dot vertical as a parameter while creating an object for scroll bar class. So that particular statement does not contain the scroll bar creation. That particular class does not contain the scroll bar creation. That particular class contains the interaction, how we can interact with the system files in order to create scroll bars. But here, when we want to create a scroll bar, we use J scroll bar space object name equal to new J scroll bar, and we can create either horizontal or vertical depending upon our situation. That J scroll bar class itself contains the creation code for scroll bar. There is no need to depend upon the system files. There is no need to use the peer files. So this is how this Sphinx package is going to preserve the machine independency feature of Java programming language. At the same time, this Sphinx is used to create graphical user interface components. Right? So these are the two points. There is no need to depend upon the system files while creating graphical user interface components using Sphinx. And this is how Java is preserving machine independency feature of Java by using Sphinx. Right? And coming to the next one, up to now we have seen about the introduction of AWT and Sphinx. We have seen AWT as a heavyweight components and Sphinx as a lightweight components. And AWT is violating the machine independency feature of Java, and Sphinx are preserving the machine independency of feature of Java. Okay. Now, coming to the next topic, AWT layouts. So what do you mean by layout in the sense? When we are dealing with the graphical user interface components, we have two things, majorly two things, components and containers. Components and containers. So we are going to add components to a container. For example, window is a container. Text field is a component. We can add the text field to the window. So that component can be placed on a container, but the vice versa is not possible. We cannot add window to a text field. We cannot add window to a text field, but we can add text field to a window. So here we have containers and components. We can see when we observe the package structure of AWT, we will know the components and containers, right? So here we are going to add multiple number of components to a container. So when we are adding multiple number of components to a container, we need to specify where a particular component should be on the container, right? So these layouts will help in order to place the components on a container. So see the two points, placing the components at a particular position within a container. For example, the entire screen you are viewing is a container, and the thing AWT layout, there is some text called AWT layout, it is a component, and there are two point symbols. Those two are called as components because we are adding all these components to a particular container. So these layouts will help in placing the components at a particular position within the container. And at the same time, the task of placing this component is taken care by layout manager classes. As we seen in the previous PPT, AWT package contains multiple number of classes. Okay, so some of the classes are, we already seen, if you want to create a button, we use button class. And if you want to create a checkbox, we use checkbox class. If we want to create a text area, we use text area class. Similar to all those classes like button, text area, scroll bar, checkbox, list, choice box, etc., there are some more classes which deals with the layout. These classes are called as layout manager classes. Let us look at what are the different type of layout manager classes that AWT contains. So there are five types of layout manager classes in AWT. There are five types of layout manager classes. So these are the names of those five types of layout manager classes. First one is border layout, card layout, grid layout, grid tag layout, and flow layout. So apart from these five layouts, there is one more layout called as null layout. Speaking to be frank, it is not a manager class. It is not a layout manager class, but we can arrange the components using null layout by using a method called as set bounce method. I will explain about this null layout in the future programs, but keep this one in mind. In AWT, there are five types of layout: border, card, grid, grid bag, and flow layout. Other than these five layouts, there is one more layout, and actually we cannot call it as a layout. There is one more process. We can call it as a process. There is one more process in order to keep the arrangement of components on a container. The process is null layout. And when we are using null layout, we will keep the components on a container at particular position by using a method called as set bounce method. This particular method will take four parameters. The first two are the starting positions of the particular component on a container, and the next two are the height and width of the component, right? So let us look at each and every layout manager classes. Let us start with the border layout. And before going to the layouts in AWT, let us have a look at the layouts in Sphinx. Okay, so In Sphinx, there are multiple number of layouts. In those layouts, among all those layouts, the main four layouts are box layout, group layout, and scroll panel layout, sorry, scroll pane layout, and spring layout. These are the four layouts in Sphinx package. And these are the five layouts in AWT package. So don't think AWT and Sphinx both are same. Those two are different. Okay. So in order to arrange the components on a container while we are using AWT package, we have to use either both layout or path layout or grid layout or grid bed layout or flow layout or null layout. While we are dealing with the arrangement of components on a container by using Sphinx package, we have to use box layout, group layout, scroll pane layout, and spring layout, etc. Okay. So, and one more thing, I'm not going to discuss about these layouts in Sphinx in detail because it is not in the syllabus, and I'm not going to discuss about forever from the syllabus. But the layouts of AWT are in the syllabus, so I'm going to discuss about the AWT layouts. Right? So we have already seen in the previous PPT that there are five different layouts in the AWT package. Those five layouts are border layout, grid layout, grid layout, card layout, and flow layout. So let us have a close look at the border layout. So in border layout, it is used to arrange the components in five regions. So the entire container, it may be a window, it may be a panel, or it may be anything. We call it as a container. It may be an applet also. So the entire container is going to be divided into five regions. Five regions. So those five regions are, these names are very similar to us. North, east, west, and south. Okay. And center. So the top of the screen is called as north in border layout. And the right side of the screen is called as east. Left is called as west. And the bottom of the screen is called as south. And the remaining part other than this north, south, east, west is called center. So in border layout, the entire container is divided into five types: north, south, east, west, and center. And one more thing, in border layout, we can only add five components. One in the north, one in the south, one in the east, one in the west, and one in the center. If we want to add a sixth component, then for example, in north, we have already one text field. And in the same place, in the north only, we want to add one more text field. And the second text field is visible to all the people. The first text field will be overlapped by the second text field. So at a particular point of time, we are only able to add only five components on the border layout. That is the main drawback of border layout, because if you are dealing with a huge application may contain n number of components, but this border layout is limited only to five components. We can add 100 components, no problem, but only five components are visible. That is the main problem with the border layout, right? So how these are some of the examples. So for example, if I want to add a button which is the object name B1 at the north of the border layout. North means top of the screen, right? So here, F is a frame class object. I have copied these statements from one of the program, and I will show the program in the next classes. So F is a frame class object, and add is a method which was used to add the components to a container. F is a container, and B1 is a component. Keep that in mind. So F dot add of B1 comma. So we are trying to add that particular B1 button at north. So we are using border layout dot north. That north should be in uppercase, right? And if I want to add that particular B1 button at center, so I have to write the statement as F dot add of B1 comma border layout dot center. Similarly, so in these five statements, F is called as frame class object, and frame is a container. We all know that frame is a container. F is called as frame class object, and these things B1, B2, B3, B4, and B5. These five are the buttons. Let us assume these five are the buttons. So we want to add one button at the north, one button at the south, one button at the center, one button at the west, and one button at the east. So if you want to add B1 button at the north, we have to use the, we have to write the statement as f dot add of B1 dot border layout dot north. And if we want to add the button B2 at the south, we have to use the statement as f dot add of B2 comma border layout dot south. And similarly, if you want to add something on the west, for example, I have a checkbox. The object name of the check particular checkbox is C1, and I want to add that C1 at center. So I have to use the, I have to write the statement as f dot add of C1 comma border layout dot center. So this is how we can add the components at different positions of the screen by using this border layout. Okay. And one more thing. So see this picture closely. So this entire screen is divided into three regions, north, south, east, west, and center. So if I have only one component, and I add that one component, for example, I have only one button, and I don't want to add any more components, I have only one button. If I add that one button at center, that button will occupy the entire screen. If we are having only one component, the component will occupy the entire screen. And if that particular button is added to east, that particular button will occupy east and center. If we have only one component and that one component is added at center, it will occupy the entire screen. And if that one component is added at the east, it will occupy east and center. And if that one particular one component is added at north, it will occupy north and center. Okay, so that center position will be occupied by any of the region. So if we are adding only one component or two components, it depends. Okay, so next one. The second type of layout in AWT package, that is the card layout. Oh, what happens is we all know three-dimensional axis, X, Y, and Z axis. We all know that Z axis will be away from our eye, or it is coming to near to our eye when we draw it on a board or when we see it on a paper. So this in this card layout, the elements become our elements, because the components are added. The components are added on the Z axis. And one of the drawback of this card layout is we can only see one component at a particular point of time. If we observe the bottom, there is one diagram and there are three boxes which are in red color. So only container three boxes visible fully. And if you want to view container two, we have to click on the container two, and the container two will comes in front of you. And the container two is visible completely. If we want to see container one, we have to click on container one, and that particular container one will comes front and it is visible completely. So here the main drawback is we can only view a single component at a particular point of time. So all the components are added over the Z axis one after another, and they are slightly visible. And if we want to view the component fully, we have to make a click on that one, and that particular component is visible. This is the card layout. And next one, grid layout. This grid layout is used to divide the entire screen into multiple number of grids, or you can also call grids. So by using this grid layout, the entire screen is divided into multiple number of grids. And each and every rectangle, only one component is displayed. We can add one or more components, but only one component is displayed. We have seen in border layout, the entire computer screen is divided into five parts, north, south, east, west, and center. If we try to add two components to the center, the last component which was added will be visible. Similar to that, if we add two or more components on the same rectangular grid, the last component which was added will be displayed, and the first component which was already placed in that particular grid is not visible. So let us have a close look at this grid layout. So the grid layout is used to arrange the components in a rectangular grid. One component is displayed in each rectangle. So for example, I want to divide the entire output screen or entire container into four parts. I have to write the statement as set layout. So there is one example statement in the above the diagram, above the picture, set layout of new grid layout 3, 3, which means we are going to divide, F means the frame, we are going to divide frame into 3, 3 means 3 rows and 3 columns, total 9 parts. So the entire frame is going to be divided into nine rectangular grids. So the rectangular grids or nimbo has been given below 1, 2, 3 horizontally, 4, 5, 6 and next horizontal and 7, 8, 9. So if we add one component, it will be added at 1. If we add the second component, it will be added at position number 2. If we add the third component, it will be added at position number 3. So the component filling will be left to right. And after the completion of first line, it will come to the next line and it will come to the next line. So the first row will be filled, followed by the second row, followed by the third row, followed by the fourth row, if we have fourth row, followed by the fourth row, and so on. So the components in grid layout will be filled left to right, top to bottom. So if I want to divide the entire screen into 4 parts, I have to mention F dot set layout of new grid layout 2, 2. So that particular statement will divide the entire computer screen into 4 parts. And if I want to divide the computer screen into some 100 parts, I have to write the statement as F dot set layout of new grid layout 10, 10. So 10 rows and 10 columns, which will give 100 rectangular grids. So in that we can display 100 components at a time. And let us look at these particular 9 parts. So we want to divide the screen into 9 parts. That way we have passed 3, 3 as a parameter for the grid layout method, sorry, grid layout class. So that grid layout, particular grid layout class will divide the entire screen into 3 rows and 3 columns. So total 9 components, we can place up to 9 components. What happens if we place a 10th component? That particular 10th component will occupy the first position. For example, I have placed a button initially. So the button will be placed at component number 1. So if I add some other 8 components and I am trying to add the 10th component, if I add the 10th component to that particular frame, that first component will be overlapped. That button will not be displayed. And the component which was added newly will be displayed on the output screen, at the place of that first component. Okay, next one. And this is the next layout in AWD. There is a grid back layout. So the things which I explained in the grid layout are all applicable to the grid back layout. In grid back layout also, if we want to divide the screen into 4 parts, we have to pass new grid back layout of 2, 2. So the screen is divided into, the output screen is, our output container is divided into 2 rows and 2 columns. If I want to divide into 9 parts, we have to give 3, 3. So it will be divided into 3 rows and 3 columns, total 9 parts. So similar to the grid layout, grid back layout is also used to divide the screen and used to place the components. But the major difference between grid layout and grid back layout is, so we can rearrange, the components in different sizes horizontally or vertically within their baseline. So here we have, that one has some borders. In grid layout, we cannot increase or decrease the size of the component. But in grid back layout, we can decrease the size of the component and we can increase the size of the component according to the baseline. And this is the grid back layout. And the last but not the least layout, and this is automated, we can call it as an automated layout. The last layout in AWD practice, that is the flow layout. So in flow layout, it is used to arrange the components in a line, one after another, in a flow. And it is the default layout of applet or panel. So while we are dealing with applets, in unit number 4 or 5, something. So in applets, we never use this layout because applet default uses flow layout. Okay, so when we have, let us say, when we have 5 components, when we add the first component, it will be placed at top left position. When we add the second component, if the second component is having the space in the first line, it will be added in the first line. If there is no space in the first line, it will automatically comes to the next line and it will be added at the next line. And if you add third component, it will find a place beside the second component. If the space is enough, it will be automatically added at the second line. If the space is not enough, it will occupy the third line. Similarly, all the components will find the space in the same line. If the space is enough, it will be added in the same line. If the space is not enough, it will comes to the next line. So depending upon the size of the components and size of the output screen or size of the container, the components are automatically arranged. So this is why we call this flow layout as default layout, because any number of components we add will be automatically arranged on the container or the output screen depending upon the size of the output screen and size of the component. So here in this diagram, we are added five components. The first component occupies the top left. The second component is enough in the same line, so it is added beside the one. And the third component is also enough, that is why it is beside the number two. And the fourth component beside number four, and fifth component beside number four. Now, if we add the sixth component, there is no space in that particular output screen for the sixth component in the same line. So that sixth component will be added in the second line automatically. There is no need to do anything. These components will be arranged automatically depending upon the size of the container or size of the output screen or size of the components. And finally, if you have any queries regarding this video, you can just comment in the comment session. So I will give reply as soon as possible. And finally, thank you all the viewers who are viewing this video. And in the future also, I will continue making these such videos. Thank you very much for spending your valuable time with us.